Cliff injured his back yesterday while on call. That's what he tells me. So we've arranged a special accommodation for Cliff.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I've never been to talk sitting down, but to be honest with you, you just saw my leg give way. I promise you everything's okay. At least that's what the orthopedic surgeon said. So does anyone actually know what an interventional radiologist is? Yeah? Good. Well, that's more than most audiences. And after hearing a day of obesity talks, you actually know more than my usual audience about obesity, which makes this quite good for me. I can actually get you to the happy hour a little faster. So an interventional radiologist is a minimally invasive proceduralist. We do everything with image guidance through needles and wires, either through the skin or through arteries or veins. So no incision and very minimally invasive. And it's very weird I'm here talking to you about this, because really what you've heard over the last day are basic scientists and well-known clinical scientists and bariatric surgeons speaking. So why would I be speaking about this? Well, today I'm going to talk to you about a procedure we've been developing over the last decade that we call bariatric embolization. It started out being called gastric artery chemoembolization, which was a direct kind of relative in our thought to our way of treating liver cancer. And so I'm going to tell you about our early data and start out with a little bit of background so that we know kind of where we're starting. And most of it you've heard already, so I can go through it very quickly. And I'll tell you about our preliminary data, which is very exciting. So I don't have to show you this slide. This is something we published in JVIR and demonstrates that, we as a country have been getting heavier and heavier over the last, decade. I mean, I'm sorry, five decades, to a point where we have an obesity crisis. And that this obesity crisis affects every organ system in the body. So this is not just an organ, this is not a disease of obesity alone, it's a disease of the lungs, of the heart, of the liver, of cancer, et cetera. And we know that medical therapy can be effective, but this is, I guess, that same article that Larry just talked about. You beat me to it by one presentation. But this is the folks from The Biggest Loser who mostly regain their weight after they'd lost all that weight on TV. And some of the reasoning behind that was that their metabolism had actually slowed down to a point that when they were back in the normal environment, it was hard to maintain their weight loss. So we know that medical therapy, and when I mean medical therapy, I mean diet, exercise, intervention, psychological therapy is vital. It's important, but it's not the only answer. And we know that the most effective way to treat obesity right now is bariatric surgery, right? And there are many different types, and you've seen those today. I'm going to point out one more time. This is the Roux-en-Y gastric bypass, and this is the sleeve gastrectomy, and this is the gastric banding, which we're going to kind of just focus on these for right now. And what you can see is that although very effective, and we know that they're effective, right, they also have significant complications, which is the nature of an invasive procedure. But again, these are the best way to treat obesity that we currently have at our disposal. And there's another problem that is starting to come out with bariatric surgery, and this is not necessarily related to the most modern minimally invasive surgeries, but bariatric surgery in general, which is that JAMA article reviews demonstrated that if you look at overall costs, there was no significant healthcare cost savings from bariatric surgery over time. Now, that doesn't mean patients didn't get better, it just meant that overall cost savings weren't there. And as our country gets more and more cost conscious about its healthcare, that could become important. And so the question is, we have diet and exercise, which almost all of us have attempted to do at some point in time in our lives, and most patients will try this. And some patients will try the more invasive things like Roux-en-Y gastric bypass, or such as sleeve gastrectomy. But there's a big gap in the middle, and I think you heard Jay talk about some device today. He talked about the duodenal sleeve. He talked about my team from CBID who helped him build the oral gastric sleeve with the pills, right? And I don't mean gastric, I mean duodenal sleeve. And of course, the drug companies are just going crazy right now. This is a multi-billion dollar industry, so every company out there is trying to put out some type of anti-obesity medication, right? So we decided to jump into the game. And why, right? Well, we now know, and you know more than probably anybody else in D.C. right now, other than the bariatric surgery group, that the stomach is not just an organ into which we put our foodstuffs. It's a hormonal organ. And we're going to focus today, at least in the next 10 minutes, on ghrelin, which we already heard was a very potent hunger-stimulating hormone. And it sits in direct balance with things like GLP-1 and PYY, which promote satiation, right? And we're very lucky because, you know, there's this balance, right? Ghrelin is one of the most potent and one of the only hunger-stimulating hormones we know. And it's primordial. It's there from the smallest of mice all the way to the most advanced mammals. And when you're in the fasting state, it predominates and you eat. And when you're fed, it decreases. And these other hormones of satiety, GLP-1, PYY, CCK, leptin peak, and you feel satiated, okay? And in bariatric surgery, we've seen that there is a shift of hormones towards the satiated state. Okay, so that's the basic concept, right? Ghrelin, important hunger hormone. Luckily, I'm going to show you it's made in a very particular place. When you're hungry, or ghrelin causes hunger. When you're fed, ghrelin drops. These other hormones increase. And bariatric surgery gets to that directly. And there are a number of great papers that show that these hormones alter very quickly after bariatric surgery. And we're very lucky because the reason we're happy today is because ghrelin is primarily made in the top of the stomach, called the fundus. Right? So the stomach is divided into the cardia, the fundus, the body, the antrum, the pylorus, and this is the duodenum and the bowel. And when you look at Roux-en-Y gastric bypass, food bypasses the fundus, so ghrelin is not expressed. When you look at banding, which is the less effective of the bariatric surgeries, food still hits the fundus. When you look at sleeve gastrectomy, again, most of the fundus is removed, and ghrelin-producing cells, called XA cells, aren't exposed to food flow. So we... Oh, I hit the wrong button. Okay, hit the right button. So we said to ourselves, you know, we're lucky because we really know vascular anatomy better than anybody else in the body. We live in the blood vessels, okay? And so we said to ourselves, well, if the fundus of the stomach produces all that ghrelin, why not go to the artery that feeds the fundus, try to block the blood flow and see what happens, right? Pretty interventional radiology approach, right? We have a certain number of hammers and nails, and we use them for everything. But in this case, about 10 years ago, we took this to the animals, and we proceeded to test serially different procedures, et cetera, to try to get a decrease in ghrelin and a decrease in weight. And this essentially is what bariatric surgery is, right? It's a catheter, so through the leg or the wrist, a little plastic catheter placed into the arteries that feed the fundus of the stomach. We deliver an embolic, and our choice is a small plastic sand called an embosphere, which is a little round calibrated piece of plastic that then wedges in these blood vessels out here, and there defunctionalizes the ghrelin production in the stomach. Sounds crazy. But over about a decade of work, we've shown in animals that we can be quite effective. We can decrease ghrelin, we can increase PYY and GLP-1, and we can lead to a decrease in weight gain in normal growing animals, because normal pigs don't lose weight. They gain about a kilogram a day, and we can drop that to a kilogram a week with this procedure. And so that led us, after all that work, to jump into an early clinical trial. And what we did here is we did this the right way, which is not the typical way for interventional radiologists. We usually get very excited and go do it and then tell everyone how great we are. We instead decided to actually take this to the FDA and go for full FDA IDE exemption, IDE approval. So that's investigational device exemption. And so this is a federally monitored study with IRB approval, and we're looking at this embosphere. We have to have a device for this. So this is our theoretical device. Now, this device has been used, literally, these little pieces of sand have been used for 20 years for everything from people who are bleeding emergently, people who have cancer. They're basically there to block blood vessels. So, and there are many different brands and types, et cetera. This is the one we chose. And partially, you know, they decided to help us with supplying funding to the lab, as did the imaging companies. And we proceeded this way. And actually, what you're seeing here is pretty much our working team. You know, we did a lot of the work here initially, along with Dr. Kretschmann, and then we brought in a team from Duke and a team from to Mount Sinai to help us work on the clinical trial. And I think most importantly is that to see that the endpoints of this trial are weight loss and 30-day adverse events. So the safety endpoint is most important. What the FDA wanted to know in the first 5 patients is, was this safe? Did anyone get really sick from this, or was people pretty much okay? And then they want to know afterwards, did they lose any weight? Okay? And this is not a double-blinded control. This is just a single-arm, kind of a pre-phase 1 or phase 1A trial. And then we did a bunch of other testing as well, including blood pressures and hormones and quality of life assessments. And we have a multidisciplinary team that includes Dr. Steele and our entire weight management center at Johns Hopkins, run by Dr. Cheskin. And basically, it's a very simple inclusion criteria. You must have a BMI of 40 or above, so you have to be morbidly or severely obese, and you can be otherwise completely healthy. So pre-diabetic is as far as the FDA would let us push it, okay? Which means anything else excludes you, really, for this particular trial. Now, this is a clinical trial. It's a safety trial, so this isn't what reality will be eventually. This is just where we're at now. And just so you know, it's a very rigorous trial. We're putting these patients through a lot, and the goal is to really not just determine the safety and efficacy, but actually to look at what do we need to monitor these patients safely, and what can we lose in future trials, because we know this is the first of hopefully many. And so what we'll see is that these patients are enrolled. We look at their anatomy with a CAT scan. We scope them with an endoscopy to make sure they have no ulcers, and they have no polyps and no cancer. And we do a lot of blood work, and we get a lot of baseline questionnaires. We then put them in a wait, 1 month run-in, at least the most recent patients. The first five we did not. But from this point on, everyone gets a 1 month run-in in weight management where they're expected to show up and show commitment to the trial. And that's really important, right? Because this is not a magic bullet. There is no such thing. And if patients believe it to be so, they'll fail, okay? And then they get their embolization, which at this point is shown to be about a 90-minute procedure, and I think it'll be about 45 minutes once we take all the research parts out of it. Like, there are certain things we do during the procedure to make sure that the anatomy is perfect, et cetera. They get gastroprotective agents to make sure they don't, you know, if they do ulcerate, which we know about a third of our pigs did, that they're minor ulcers. And then they come into the hospital to make sure they're okay, and then they come back, and they get these tests repeated, including gastric emptying studies and endoscopies, which is all just to see what's happening to the stomach, right? Is the stomach getting ischemic, which you know it is? Is it ulcerating? Are there any problems? Is the stomach not moving forward anymore? Poor forward gastric motility. And I just want to show you kind of what we do and what this looks like. So this is a 31-year-old man, 6'3". He's actually our only male in the protocol until today. We had two other males who are going to be embolized in a couple weeks. He's pretty big guy. BMI is 44.9. He's our second patient. And what we can see here, and I'll stop this midway through, because you're not interventional radiologists, and I didn't stop it at all. Okay, so this is a little catheter coming up from the leg, parked in the blood vessel that feeds the liver and the spleen, and there's a blood vessel coming up here that feeds the stomach. And that's our guy, okay? So we get into that with a teeny little, we try to get into that. It's easier to get into that than to forward the slide. Okay, we get into that with a tiny little microcatheter, and you inject this contrast, right? So this is a subtracted image. There are bones back there, and there's colon. But this is the stomach, and you see that nice fine perfusion of the stomach, those curlicue vessels. Well, we disrupt that by blocking it with these little blood blocking agents, and now you see a curtailed blood flow to the stomach. Now, there's lots of other blood flow to the stomach. There's blood flow from the splenic, which is called the short gastric. There's gastroepiploic. So we're pretty confident that this is safe. And this is our first eight patients. So this is our safety data that allowed the FDA, actually after these five, to let us proceed with the next 15 patients. And they're all pretty much pretty large patients, right? BMIs of about 44 and a half, or 44 or above. Pretty much all women. Okay, they're all African American, so it's the patient population in East Baltimore. But as you just heard Dr. Apple talk about, that's probably the most difficult patient population to affect good weight loss in. And this is our primary endpoint that the FDA cared about, right? So basically, there were no major adverse events, right? So anything that would cause continued hospitalization, etc. There were basically three minor ulcers that were healed by 3 months, right? That was very expected. We're causing ischemia. We're not burning the duodenum as the gastroenterology device could do, but we are making it ischemic. And we had one mild pancreatitis, which we believe was because we were trying to get out to actually embolize a second blood vessel in that patient for the first time, and we were probably got a few extra of our embolics in the wrong place. And that happens sometimes, right? And so that's why you have to be very careful with your imaging, et cetera. And so you can also get a little pancreatitis, which means inflammation of the pancreas, just from manipulating the artery that feeds that whole area. So we don't know why that happened, but this patient never had it clinically. We just drew labs and saw it. So really no major adverse events, and minor adverse events were pretty minimal, and our weight loss is pretty good. So our excess weight loss at 3 months is about 10 pounds, and in about 6 months, about this is a percent, 10%, and 13% at 6 months. And our mean change is about 21. Now, really, this is the number that means the most because this is a very small sample size. But that's pretty much what we're talking about, which really for what is designed as a safety study isn't bad, all right? And I will tell you the first five patients, only one of them actually went to their diet intervention. The rest just took the embolization and went home. And what's really neat is we're seeing in hunger appetite scale a significant drop, which makes sense if you're making the stomach a little bit injured, about 81% at 2 weeks. And then at 4 weeks, about 59%. So it's starting to creep back up again. And then still down about 30% at 3 months, right? So that begs the question, what's going to happen in the long run? Well, we'll find out as more data comes in, right? Do we have to repeat this? Does it have to be combined with a drug? Do we have to use a smaller embolic? All right, and the same thing, a drop in caloric intake was in parallel, okay? Now, these hormones, we only have run this on a few patients, but you're seeing a trend already, and it's only a trend. It's not significant. We're not going to report it anywhere, but we're showing a decrease in ghrelin, which is that hunger hormone, and elevation of these hormones of satiety. So I can't tell you exactly what's happening, but it looks like we're going in the right direction, and this is going to be really, hopefully, we have a significant more study. So overall, we think that this is well taught, and I call this larger particles, right? Because in our animals, we used 50 micron particles, but the FDA had us multiply that by 10. So we're using 400 micron particles. And the reason for that is they felt it would be safer not to have as embolization right into the, as deep into the stomach wall and preserve the stomach wall. We have the same ulceration rate in patients as we do in animals. So I'm not sure that's really necessarily true, but that's what they thought. And it looks like it might be effective. I can't really say more than that, but it does look like, at least in the short term, that we're seeing weight loss that is likely attributable to this procedure. Now, again, preliminary data. What are the next steps? So we've just finished this. We're in this phase right now. And then this is our typical. We're going to go into our randomized control trial and save the world. But actually, what we're going to do is we're going to take a break in between, and we're going to actually dial on our bead size. So we're going to convince the FDA to let us go smaller, and we're going to see if there's anything we can do in combination to increase our effectiveness so that we can actually reach the type of evidence we would need to actually make a trial like this, a randomized control trial, effective. And I like to always end this with, I think, what we've heard about over and over again today, which is I'm an interventional radiologist, and I can pretty much only affect the physiologic and metabolic side of things a little bit, right? I can help with the physiology, and it looks like I might be able to affect the hormones. I can't affect the rest of this, right? Which is why a multidisciplinary approach and a really deep understanding of obesity is important for treating the obese patient. So that's my talk. Thank you.